Yeah, thanks for coming to our talk. So basically what we did, we reverse engineered the hardware of the hoverboards. You probably all know, like these annoying things driving around. And we wrote our own firmware for these so we can use the motors and everything for our own projects. And we would like to give you a brief overview of how we did this so you can get your own moving object moving. We will split the talk in two parts. First of all, I will explain you like the basics, how you get the firmware on the mainboard. And later in the second part, Jan-Henrik will show you how to build your moving object, some practical advice, and so on. So how this all started was with hoverboards being the Christmas gift ever, 2014. Maybe you can remember, like, my sister also got one. Everyone wanted them. And yeah, it was like quite a big thing. However, they are not so well engineered. So 2 years later, these things started showing up on eBay and eBay Kleinanzeigen. You can get them for 50 euros. Currently, you can get them even for 10 euros. So it's a quite cheap hardware, and as with every cheap hardware, people are starting to get them, to start to hack them. And the first thing people did on Hackaday was to trying to reverse engineer the internal serial protocol the hoverboard uses for internal communication. So there were some projects that were able to control the motors with Arduino. However, it was still the original software running on the boards. About 2017, there was kind of a leak of the original Chinese source code on the hoverboards, and we used that to take apart the firmware and to write our own control functions to use this firmware with the mainboards. However, this doesn't work so well because it's a patchwork of old software and new software. So in 2018, we started to build a new firmware completely from scratch. We reverse engineered the schematics of the hoverboard and did everything from scratch with a now more clean firmware. So here we have a look to the inside of a typical hoverboard. You can see the battery on the left. It's a quite big battery for such a device, for consumer device. Jan-Henrik will talk about this battery later. We have two sensor boards on each side of the hoverboard. These are the units that measure the angle to regulate the position and the angle of the hoverboard. These communicate via UART with the mainboard, which is here. This mainboard contains the actual controller, the MOSFETs for the BLDC controllers. And we, of course, have the motors, which are 350 watts by spec with Hall sensors. And these go up to 40 kilometers per hour and 800 watts before they start burning. This is what such a motor looks like from the inside. You can see the copper coils, the permanent magnets on the outside. Here are the Hall sensors. And as I explained earlier, you can get these motors for about 10 euros. So these hoverboards are completely broken. Like, the battery is flat and the electronics is ripped apart. So it's only the motors, but it's still 10 euros for two motors, so 5 euros per motor, which is excellent for such a nice motor. Now you have these motors and you have to control them. Unfortunately, you can't just apply voltage and they start spinning because these are synchronous motors, so you need a controller for them. I picked three typical motor controllers you may already know: the FADA ESC, Otter Control, and the original hoverboard hardware. The FADA ESC is engineered quite nice. It's open source hardware, has lots of currents and lots of interfaces. However, it's quite expensive. It costs about 120 euros. Maybe less if you assemble it yourself, and it's only for a single motor, so if you want to build a moving armchair, so you need two of them, which is also quite expensive. Otto Control is basically the FADA ESC, but cost optimized. It has a bit less current, but also lots of interfaces. However, it's still quite expensive because you also need two of these, which is about 100 euros, which is quite a lot for 10 euros motors. So what you actually want to use is the original hoverboard hardware, because it already contains two BLDC controllers. Also, it's dirt cheap. You can get these PCBs new from eBay or AliExpress. Unfortunately, it's proprietary Chinese hardware, and you don't really have interfaces. You have to hack them to get data in and out of this mainboard. And it's also quite large compared to the other to the other controllers, which might be a problem if you want to build a small moving object. Yeah, as I said, you can get these boards together with the sensor boards on AliExpress, for example, for like very cheap. Other sources may include Amazon, eBay, Alibaba. You can get them everywhere. It's really easy to get them. This is what such a typical mainboard looks like. The main part is the STM32. It's an ARM processor which does all the controlling of the MOSFETs and the hoverboard. There is a discrete DC to DC converter in the middle, which converts the 40 volt battery voltage down to a more usable voltage of 15 volts, which is for example used by the gate drivers. This voltage is then regulated down further to 5 volts and 3.3 volts by linear regulators for the STM32 and the Hall sensors. Here you can see the 6 MOSFETs per side, which are used for the half bridges to control the 3 phases of the motor. These may vary. These are the parts found in our mainboards, but like the Chinese solder in whatever they found on the local market. So these vary a lot. They may also vary in one mainboard, so you can find different MOSFET types in one assembly. Yeah, what else? These are the gate drivers. These are fully discrete, which is quite nice because if one blows, you can simply replace it by fixing the individual transistors that might be broken. We have a piezo buzzer, which is very important. We have two ways of measuring the current in the motor. On each side of each motor has a DC current shunt to measure the current flowing into or from the battery. And we also have a current sensing via two low side MOSFETs via op amps that amplify the very low signal of the RDS on current sensing of the low side MOSFET. We have also quite some connectors on there. First of all is the power connector or the power button connector, which is used to switch on and off the mainboard. Then we have the XT60 main power connector, which connects to the battery. We have the main motor wires, which go to the left and right motor, of course. We have a charging connector to plug in a charging jack to charge the battery. We have a programming interface, which is very interesting for you because this can be used to flash our own firmware to the STM32. We have the left Hall sensor cable for the motor. You can get like 5 volts with 100 milliamps max out of this if you want to add a display or whatever. The right Hall sensor cable. And the most interesting thing for us, the cables that originally connect to the two sensor boards that we don't need now anymore, because these are the ports we mainly use to interface the main board. On the left side, we have two ADC channels that can be used to measure analog values. Also, these can be used for UART. And on the right, we have also a UART interface, which also can be used for I2C, which is very nice because you can connect, for example, a Wii Nunchuck, which also uses I2C to interface with the mainboard. The software is on GitHub, and you can simply clone it. To get like basic operation of your moving object, all you really need is the config.h file. In here are different configurations. First of all, you can configure a user debug interface, which can be used to get values for debugging out of your mainboard. You can choose whether to use user 2 or user 3, either if you want to use the left or the right user port. You can also set the baud rate. Then you can configure what you want to use to control your moving object. As I said before, you can connect, for example, potentiometers as an analog value. You can connect a Nintendo Nunchuck, or you can use a common RC remote receiver, which gives out a PPM sum signal. To control the driving behavior, there are 3 variables, or defined variables. First is the filter. This is like a moving average filter. This is that is used to filter the controls you give in there. You usually don't need this filter, but if you have, for example, analog potentiometers, you may want to filter the values in software to get like a smoother driving behavior. And there's also speed coefficient, which is basically a multiplier for like the throttle, and you get a steer coefficient, which is basically determines how much your moving object steers if you move left or right. You can see example configs, for example, for our bobby car. At our bobby car, we don't have software steering because we have like a hardware steering wheel. That's why we don't need a speed coefficient. Also, the motors are mounted so that they need to spin in the wrong direction, which is why we use a negative speed coefficient. So this is the point where you want to like modify things to get your moving object moving as you want. Independently of how you configure all these things, what matters in the end are four global variables, which are PVML, PVMR, weak L, and weak R. To get a better understanding of what these variables do, we first need to take a closer look on how motor controllers work in theory. On the right, you can see a simplified illustration of what a BLDC motor looks like. In the middle, you can see the permanent magnet rotating clockwise and the two field vectors Q and D, which are generated by the motor controller, which are also rotating synchronously to the motor. The Q vector is perpendicular to the magnetic field of the permanent magnet, and thus creates the actual throttle. To get a better understanding of what this looks like, here's a better animation. You can see the field of the permanent magnet and the motor controller rotating the Q field correspondingly using the Hall sensors as position information. This is done in software quite easily by using the plot WM function, which takes the position, which is calculated by the state of the Hall sensor, and outputs three variables, U, V, and W, which are the PVM values for the corresponding phase of the motor. These functions also take the PWL and PWR variables, which are basically the length of the vector. These range from minus 1,000 to plus 1,000, and correspond to a torque of the motor from minus 100% to plus 100%. So if you set these variables, your motor will start spinning at a given throttle, at a given torque. This is actually all you need for most basic moving objects. So what about these other two variables? Well, the thing with BLDC motors is that these are like copper coils, and the coils, the thing with inductors is that their electrical resistance increases as the frequency increases. So as you speed up the motor, the inductance will increase as well, and the DC resistance will increase as well, and thus there is a point at a given voltage where you can't reach higher speeds without modifying something else. For a typical hoverboard setup, this is the case for a speed of about 20 kilometers per hour, which is already quite fast, but you can go faster with a trick called field weakening or phase advance. That's where this other vector is interesting, because it's in parallel with the magnetic field of the permanent magnet. We can apply a second magnetic vector that is in reverse direction of the permanent magnet field, and thus weakens this permanent magnet field. By weakening the magnetic flux of the permanent magnet, we can lower the inductance of the motor, and thus get higher currents into the motor at a given voltage. This looks in software quite similar as before. However, now we don't take the position left or position right variables, but we take the position left plus one variable. Because in our motor, unfortunately, we don't have position information for a 90-degree vector, because we only have six position points per pole. So we take the next closer to 90 degrees, which is 60 degrees, to generate a second field vector, which then sums up together with the Q vector to generate the resulting vector, which is a bit advanced to the actual vector we would use to normally operate a motor. That's why this procedure is called phase advance or field weakening, because it weakens this vector. This can be used to get your moving object moving even faster. This variable reaches from from 0 to 1,000, and yeah, can be used to get like an additional speed boost. What this looks like can be seen in this video. Here's our bobby car. We use like this additional code in the main C function to get some weak some value in these weak variables if the button for the turbo boost is pressed and there's already a given speed which is close to full speed. And yeah, this looks like this. So this is normal speed and this is with field weakening. Without and with. And you can see it's quite some speed difference. And this would, on the road, this would result in a speed of about 30 kilometers per hour. And yeah, just that you know what these weak L and weak variables do, yeah, you can have a closer look at the code in the description on GitHub if you want to know more about them. Yeah, that's how to configure all the software. If you are happy with your configuration, you can build the software. If you have all the tool chains set up correctly, you should be able to simply type in make to get like the binary file. And this binary file has to be flashed to the STM32 on the mainboard. For this, you need an ST-Link V2, which is a programmer for this chip. You can get them for €2 on AliExpress or eBay or whatever, or here on the GPN if you ask kindly. You have to connect the SVD interface accordingly to the pinout I showed earlier or by this picture. Second, you need a power source to power the mainboard, which can be, for example, the original battery that is charged. It shouldn't be too empty. And another important thing, you need to bridge the power button because there's a latch circuitry which is held up by the STM32. And if you reset the STM32 during programming, you may power off the power of the STM32 you're trying to program. So it would kill itself and may break the firmware. So you need to make sure to either permanently press the power button or to simply jumper it. Yeah, then you can unlock the flash of the STM32 using make unlock, and then you can flash it using make flash. After this, the firmware is on the mainboard, and you can try to debug things if it doesn't work out of the box. For this, as I said earlier, you have a USART connection. You can configure this in the config file. You can connect a USB to USART converter to one of the sideboard connectors, and then there is the set scope channel function, which can be called with a channel and a variable you want to plot. And then this is locked to the console, either in ASCII by comma-separated ASCII, or if you want to plot these variables, there's also a GUI called servo term, which can be used to plot things if you want to have like a continuous view of these variables. Also, there was a fork recently on our GitHub repository by Tom Tinkering, I would like to announce. He built an additional function in our firmware to interact with a GUI he wrote, and this can be used to tune variables in real time and to plot these variables as well. I didn't try this myself, but it looks quite promising. So if you need more debugging than plotting variables, you may give this a try. The link is here. Yeah, now the firmware is on our boards and the motors are spinning. Now you need to build your moving object, and for this, Jan-Henrik can give you some advice. Yeah.
To get your moving objects on the road, we first of all need a mobile power source. Lithium ion or lithium polymer battery is the most fitting choice there. And the most common battery that you may encounter will be the original hoverboard battery, as it's very cheap and quite good. It is a 10S2P, that means 10 cells in series, 2 in parallel lithium-ion battery. That sums up to around about 42 volts at 4,400 milliampere hours. If you want to go faster, therefore need a higher voltage, or you just want to have a bigger battery, more power, then you can also use some low-cost lithium-ion or polymer batteries, for example, bought from Hobby King. The highest voltage that the mainboards can handle is around about 55 volts, which sums up to a 13S battery. And the biggest battery that we have used by now is a 16 ampere hour battery at 12S, which sums up to around about 6 cells in parallel. One of the features of the original hoverboard batteries is that they have protection internal. it looks like such a balancer. It features an overcurrent, over temperature, and under voltage protection for the cells, which is quite handy. If you buy some lithium polymer cells, they usually don't have that, but you can build one yourselves from a cheap balancer board from eBay and some XC60 connectors. We did that there with for two 6S6P batteries. So we can have a 12S6P battery pack for our bobby car. Next, you have to tell the moving objects where to go. To do so, we have quite a few options. First of all, we have two analog inputs, which range from 0 to 3.3 volts. Also, we can have an I2C input, which can be used by a Nintendo Wii nunchuck, which is quite handy. And also, we have a timer input, which, for example, can be used for PPM. Also, we have two UART inputs, or two UART interfaces, but we haven't written any firmware yet for that. So you can use them, but you will have to write some firmware yourselves. To make things easy, we created a PCB, which features a JST connector, where you can directly plug the hoverboard in. Next to that, there are some I2C pull-ups, some ADC pull-downs. These are quite useful because when you connect, for example, a potentiometer to your mainboard and a cable gets loose, the ADC input pin might be floating, which is not so cool if you are sitting on a bobby car. So you might want to use some pull-downs. So the speed goes down to zero when a cable breaks, rips off, something happens. What shouldn't happen. Next to that otter, we have a UART header, which allows you to quickly connect to UART via pin headers. One of the very handy features is you can directly plug a nunchuck into that PCB. It fits very well and snaps directly in. So you can directly connect a nunchuck to your main board without without dealing with cabling and soldering. As the nunchuck and the ADC needs 3.3 volts, or the ADC has a maximum range of 0 to 3.3 volts, and the mainboard only outputs 15 volts, we also need an LDO, or a step-down. Therefore, you can solder in an LDO there. 3.3 volts is the most common choice, but 5 volts are also possible. We also have a small ADC interconnect matrix or jumper there, which allows us to connect a second hoverboard mainboard to this PCB, and therefore allows us to drive two mainboards independently next to each other. For example, for our bobby cars, we have an all-wheel drive, and so we need the potentiometer to go to both mainboards. With this, you can directly plug two mainboards in, configure them via the interconnect jumpers, and have the ADC signals on two mainboards. This also allows you to have a crossover for UART, so the two mainboards can communicate with each other. But again, we haven't written any firmware for that yet. One of the applications we have built, the most recent one, which you can see here, is our bobby car, or bobby cars. They are featuring a 12S and a 13S lithium ion battery. Therefore, one of them has 50.4 volt battery, the other one has a 54.6 volt battery. They are featuring an all wheel drive, which. Which means that they have a total power of round about 3 horsepower. The maximum speed that we measured by GPS is 38 kilometers per hour. And that's quite a lot. When you're sitting on a bobby car, that's cool. to control them, we use analog joysticks that we glued and molded into the steering wheels. This model has a joystick glued onto it, and the other one has one actually lasered into it. Our next application that we have built, and the oldest one, is our moving armchair. We have built that for the Sha last year. It only features a 10S lithium-ion battery, but that's already enough for an armchair. It has a PPM-based remote control. You can get these from eBay for around about 40 euros, so it doesn't matter when the remote breaks, because it was only a 40 euro remote, not a 300 euro remote. And the remote will break when you are moving, when you have a moving object. It has a rear wheel drive, and only drives up to 23 kilometers per hour. And it's based upon a solid steel frame. We started that with a wooden frame, but we'll see the frame later. That didn't work out. And the next application that we have built for the Congress in Leipzig, that are our transporters. They also have the 10S lithium-ion battery from the hoverboard, and they have a quite special input. They get their signals via a game track. Game track is what Sony sold in 2004 for the PlayStation 2 as augmented reality. Game track works by having a wire tied to your hand and then fixed on the ground. Then the length of the wire and the angles of the wire are measured. Therefore, you can play golf and have some augmented reality golf with wires tied to your hand. Didn't sell that well, but you can still get these game tracks on eBay. The controllers, the interesting parts look like this. We have a potentiometer here, a wire fed through it, so you can pull there. We have a spool here, and when the wire is tilted away from the spool, this potentiometer will be turned. Therefore, you can measure the wire length and the two angles of the wire, which then looks like this. We have our wire, and with the wire, the transporter knows the length of the wire, the angle of the wire. Therefore, we can pull things up to 100 kilograms. Also these transporters have a few safety features, because autonomous moving platforms not that cool with people. We have four of these transporters working, and they all feature remote cutoff. So when a transporter turns off, all of them will turn off. We have a remote, when we press it, all of them will turn off. And if there's an error, all of them will turn off. So that's also a quite handy feature. They all have a display connected via I2C, which tells you the current battery voltage, the current which is drawn, and the length that the wire is set to. We can also use the on-off button to change the length of the wire, or the preset for that. As already said, they can carry up to 100 kilograms, which is quite a lot. And we have an advanced version, a single transporter, which features a LiDAR. That transporter can actually kind of move by itself, create a map of where it was, and then can re-navigate there. But that does not work that good on events, as there are too many people, too many tables, not enough walls for the transporter to remember. Okay, that was a video if this one was broken. Before you build your moving objects now, there's a few mechanical considerations that we might want to take. One of the most important things is that you want to use a very stable wheel suspension. As I said earlier, our first armchair was based upon some wood, and it didn't even last to the next tent on the char. So don't do that. It will not work out that good. You can do it with some very good woods. For example, multiplex was it called, which is quite stable. But if you have the tools and the time, consider making a steel frame. It's really worth it. This frame we welded on the char, and it's still operational and not broken. The armchair itself is broken, but the steel frame is still okay. So we can unscrew it, take a new armchair, and screw it onto the steel frame. So that's quite handy. Also very important is to use protection for the main board, not electrically, also electrically, but also some mechanical protection. The first Archer, like this version had no protection, and we had once a rock flying up, hitting one of the caps and breaking it off, breaking the cap off. And also that was not that cool. It worked, but not that long, because the second cap also fell off short after, and with no caps, a motor controller will burn. Another very important thing is to use very good silicone wire, or wire with lots of copper strands in it, which is also very sturdy to mechanical vibrations. I once used some aluminum wire from loudspeakers, and it broke off while we were driving, because it was the wire used. So aluminum wire is a very stable but a brittle wire, so when under mechanical stress it will break. And therefore, the ground wire broke off, and all the current flew back through an Arduino. That's also not cool. And if possible, you should use a milled motor mount. We milled one here for our bobby car, also for this bobby car. And it is really worth it. You can screw the motors to it very easily. It's very sturdy, no problems there. So if possible, do that. I guess we can also provide the file for this motor mount if you want to have it. This is already still the bobby car. A thing that we did here, which worked out surprisingly good, is a 3D printed motor mount for the front wheel. Lasts very good, but for next version we will also mill a motor mount there. And
just yesterday they broke as well.
Yeah. And another idea we came up with, but we already seen some other people came up with it too, is to use the original hoverboard framings by cutting them and removing the middle part, and then screwing them to a wooden plate. This is what we did here with the transporters, and that works quite good. So with every hoverboard you buy, you get two very okay-ish hoverboard mounts with it. That's quite a nice thing. And another electrical consideration that you might want to take, when you use some analog voltages to control your mainboard, noise will be a very heavy problem, as you will have some very long cables between your input, the potentiometer, and the mainboard. It's always a very good idea to solder some 100 nanofarads or a little bit more caps onto the mainboard directly to the ADC pins on the input wire. Without them, you will feel that your moving objects is a little bit vibrating, moving. That does quite a lot. So when building a moving object, that might be an idea. On the PCB we showed earlier, you can also solder in some ADC capacitors to smooth out the analog voltages, but still, it's a good idea to solder some to the original mainboard. This is another application we didn't do something with it yet, but some people from the internet thought it might be a good idea to use these motors as robotics attenuators, and that is actually a quite good idea, because these motors have quite a lot of power. They are 18-pole brushless DC motors, and with an encoder you can make a quite good brushless DC servo. The two images on the left are from Matt Kau. He's a guy from the O-Drive forum. You may know the O-Drive. It's also a motor controller. And he does quite a few things with that. If you want some more information, you can go there and check that thread out. It's a quite nice thread. On the right picture, you can see a motor that we opened. It's also possible to drill through the motor shaft and then fix a screw into there. So you have a motor which can be mounted on two sides. The original motors only have a mount on one side, but you can change it to a two-sided mount if you want. It's quite some work, but it's possible.
You want to build like a roller or something that needs to be mounted on both sides.
That concludes it. You can see here our bobby cars. We're driving up to 40 kilometers per hour, which is quite nice. If you have any questions, you can ask them now. You can ask them us via Twitter. You can see our handles there. And as you might already know, we will have a hands-on workshop later on 15 o'clock. I guess most, we will have a few kids there, but I guess there's already quite a few people who will want to attend to this workshop. So we will have to see if everything fits.
Yeah, I have the current status. So we have 22 people coming to the workshop. We have 20 kids. However, we have 25 kids, so five more kids, where only the Wii nunchuck is missing. So if you can get like a Wii nunchuck, or it's okay to borrow a nunchuck from someone, you can still join. There are three more. There are three more seats left. Also, we would like to give a special thanks to René Hopf and Nico Stute from the STMBL project, who helped us with the initial work on the firmware, like hardware initialization of the STM32 and so on. So if you look at the commit history, they did some work at the very beginning of the project. So yeah, special thanks to them. That's it from our side. I think we have about 15 minutes left for questions. And yeah, please ask them.
So are there questions? Please wait, so I will come to you.
So in terms of moving heavy things as opposed to moving things quickly, does a higher battery voltage result in more starting torque?
Yeah, of course. As I said before, like the main thing limiting your power, especially at high speeds, is the resistance of the motor. So with a higher with a higher battery voltage, you will get higher speeds, but also higher torques. However, at low speeds, like when you start moving, the thing limiting your current into the motor shouldn't be the resistance of the motor, because that is really, really low. You will burn your motor. So the software does some current limiting, and you can set the value for the current limiting in the config file. So if you want to get more torque, you can change this value to like increase the torque or reduce the torque if you want, like smoother starting driving behavior. Also, like torque depends on the motor size. So these hoverboard motors comes in three sizes. This is the 6-inch version. There is a 8-inch version, which has also rubber around it. And there is a 10-inch version, which has air-filled tires. All these motors have the same power, so with increased diameter, you will get higher speeds, but of course lower torque. So for bobby cars, these small motors are fun because you have like really high acceleration. For example, for our armchair, we chose bigger motors because for it we wanted to have like longer distances to travel and therefore get higher end speeds. So yeah, that's what you can do to change throttle or to change torque or speed.
Any other questions?
So no more questions, then give them a warm round of applause and thanks for the talk.
You make some photos.